Can we all stand? I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I understand that this morning we are glad that we are here to celebrate a Lord that has been blessing us for years to come, who has kept us, held us, and loved us in ways that we couldn't have loved ourselves. This morning, I know that maybe some people in here that have things with your family, things with healing and deliverance, stuff that you need to talk to God about, and you just need a moment with Him. I invite you to the altar. I invite you down to the altar to have a moment with your Lord to speak about those things. You may be even coming to thank Him for the things that He's done for your life. It isn't always dreary. Sometimes it's just, God, thank you. God, thank you. So, Father, we bless your name this morning, Lord. Have your way in this place, God. Do what only you can do, God. We say thank you, Father. We thank you for the moment to praise your holy name. We thank you for being Jesus. We thank you for dying on the cross for our sins and rising again, because as you were able to rise, we were able to rise. Have your way in our lives, God. Take over in this moment. We focus solely on you, Lord. We focus solely on you, Lord. Have your way, God. We love you. Do what you can do, God. We give it now to you, Jesus. We give it to you, Lord. We bless your holy name, oh Father.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Master God, today in the name of Jesus, we come boldly before the throne of grace, Father God, asking you to heal, deliver, and set free. Father God, in the name of Jesus, touch everyone underneath the sound of my voice, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Bless Bethel, Father God. Bless the kingdom of Jesus, Father God. Heal, deliver, and set free, Father God. Whatever they're in need for, Father God, bless them at your need, Father God. Bless them at their need, Father God. Hallelujah, glory to God. We cancel out cancer, Father God. We cancel out poverty, Father God. We give you praise, Father God. We give you glory, Father God, because you are a healer. You are a deliverer. We set free the captives, Father God, because the blood of Jesus sets us free. And we thank God for the blood of Jesus. We thank God for Jesus who died on the cross for our sins. We thank God for your Son. We glorify your name, Father God. We lift you up. We give you praise. We thank God for the house called Bethel. We just want to say thank you, Lord, for answered prayer. And we will always give you praise. We will always give you honor. We will always give you glory, Father God, for what you have done for us. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Come on, give God the glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, we come before you today on one accord, united, Father God, in Jesus' name, through your spirit and by your word. God, we glorify you this morning. God, we lift you up today. God, we say thank you, Father God. Thank you, Father God, for bringing us through. Thank you, Father God, for pulling us through. Thank you, Father God, for talking us through. Thank you, Father God, for crying us through. Thank you, Father God, because we know our help comes from you, oh God. God, we look to see the manifestations of miracles today. God, deliver us today, Father God. We want to see deliverance, Father God. God, we want to see healing in our bodies, healing in our minds, healing in our thinking, Father God. Lord, we just want you, Father God. We cannot live without you, Father. We can't do anything without you, Father God. Stand up in us today, Father God. Bless this choir, Father God. Oh God, we welcome you into this place, oh God. We welcome you. Have your way, Father God. Oh God, dwell in this place, Father God. Move in this place like you never moved before, Father God. Show up, oh God, in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you. We thank you, Father God. Oh God, it's in you, Father God, that we live, that we move, and we have our being, Father God. So God, we stand before you this morning, Father God, giving you the praise, Father God, giving you the honor, giving you the glory, Father God. Have your way. Have your way, Father God. Do it this morning, Father God. We are hurting today, Father God. There are some people who are hurting, who are crying, Father God, who had struggled to get here. So have your way in Jesus' name. Amen.
Meditations of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O God. We thank you this morning because you are God. You're holy, you're righteous, you're God from everlasting to everlasting. You're a mountain mover, Lord God, you're a mind regulator. Truly, you are a heart fixer. We thank you this morning. Lord God, somebody got off the side of their bed this morning, worried all night long, but they pressed their way here today. Somebody's in pain, Lord God, but they pressed their way here today. Somebody got a wandering child, but Lord, they pressed their way here today. Somebody don't know what tomorrow may bring, but they pressed their way here today. God, we thank you today for a bishop that's taught us we don't have to live in Lodabar. Lord God, you will bid us to come to the king's table where there is plenty of room for each and every one of us. We thank you this morning. You're mighty, you're powerful, you're God who moves mountains, Lord God. You're a God who will exalt valleys. You're still the God of the two fish and the five loaves of bread. You will provide. You're still the God who will turn water into wine. You will make a way. You're still the God who calmed the raging sea. God, we glorify you. We glorify you, God. No problem we got, you can't solve. So we lay it at your feet. And we decree we will not go out the way we came in. But we go out shouting, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. We say thank you. We say thank you. We say thank you.
And the people of God said amen. I said, and the people of God said amen. And we lift up hallelujah to your name. Can we lift up the sound of worship all over this room? I said, can we truly lift up the sound of worship all over this room? Give God what he deserves. Begin to open up your mouth and give God what he deserves. We serve a great God who deserves an even greater praise. Even in the balcony, I said, we serve a great God who deserves an even greater praise. So can you do me a favor for the next 5 seconds? Can you muster up the greatest praise that you can utter out of your mouth? God, we give you the glory. Sanctuary, for it is God who gives us the victory. now, if you know that you have the victory in Jesus, can you do me a favor and say, I got the victory? Come on, that was a little weak. Turn to the person behind you and say, I got the victory. It's so good to see you, neighbors. Come on and put a smile on your face. Smile at me. Come on, I see a few smiles. Come on, give God a good smile. Ha! Do me a favor. Now, everybody clap your hands. You're clapping real good, church.
I told Satan.
somebody clap your hands.
Wait a minute. You know how sometimes you're watching your favorite show and it gets interrupted, and they interrupt it because they have a special announcement or they have a news break? We've got a news break and a special announcement. They were up here saying healing today is mine. There's nothing better than a demonstrative example of the healing power of Jesus Christ to know that healing is ours. I'm going to let y'all get back to your... Well, I ain't going to have to let you get back. You're going to get to it anyway. I've got to break in for a special announcement about the healing power of Jesus. Bishop, are you in the room? I'm going to let y'all do your thing. Bishop, are you in the room? That's all I want to know. If you want to know about the healing power of Jesus Christ, I said, if you want to know about the healing power, he tripped over that plate right there, but ain't nothing wrong with it. Is a healer. Go ahead and have your way, sir. Well, good morning. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. My feet shall stand on Jerusalem. Say it! Say it! All I can say, I fell down, but I got up. Look at God. You want to see a miracle? You want a miracle? Look to the hills from whence cometh your help. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Hasn't he done it? Say it! Now, everybody clap your hands! Everybody clap your hands.
healing today is mine one more time.
Hey! One more time, say, healing is mine. Healing is mine. Healing today is mine. I told Satan to get thee behind. Healing today is mine. Hey, say healing. Healing.
Healing.
Healing.
Healing.
Healing.
Healing.
Say healing.
Healing.
Healing. I said, the Lord our God is good.
and he's worthy to be praised. Bishop is in the house. After 2 months, after major surgery, at 96, can stumble and get himself back up and go on and dance. Ain't nobody mad but the devil, and he wasn't coming to church anyway. So the rest of us, let's just give God a quick praise shout for the healing. Hallelujah. Oh, bless his name. Come on, shout. You don't know what God might do in your life if you shout for somebody else. Oh, bless his name. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? I said it's good to be in the house of the Lord today. We are excited about worship. We are ready to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Cedric, I know you're caught up. I need you on that organ. You done got the Holy Ghost. Get on the organ. Cedric, you done got so caught up in the Holy Ghost, he's looking at me like, what you want me to do? Every Sunday, we have been singing what is the Negro National Anthem. They sang it at the Super Bowl last week. Some people got upset saying that there's only one national anthem. No, that's the one that's indivisible with liberty and justice for y'all. But we got one that's for us. It was written by two persons right in this city. James Weldon Johnson, who wrote the lyrics. Rosamond Johnson, who was the organist at this church, who wrote the music and the melody to it. We've been singing it every Sunday. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. We're gonna lift it up to the glory and honor of God this morning. It'll be on the screen. If you don't know, now y'all should know all the words to this. If you don't know, they'll be on the screen. All of VOJ, all of fam, everybody. Let's sing it in Bethel style this morning again, to the glory of God and to the honor of our ancestors. Come on, lift every
voice.
Everybody,
lift every voice.
Let our rejoicing. Sing a song.
Sing a song full of the faith that the darkness has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day, God, let us march on to victory.
Stony the road,
stony the road,
bitter the chastening. Come on, everybody, we have come. Said every Sunday, this last verse is really, to me, the most powerful verse of all three that were written. Because even in the weary years of enslavement, our ancestors never quit on God. They said, he is the God of our weary years. This is the one I love, because sometimes you have to cry in private. But he's the God of our silent tears. Thou who has brought us. How many of you know it wasn't Abraham Lincoln that brought us? It wasn't even Barack Obama that brought us. It was nobody but God that has brought us thus far on the way. Do I have a witness? Thou who has by thy might led us into the light. Keep us. Somebody yell, keep us forever in the path. We pray. Come on, let's sing this last verse together. God of our weary years.
God.
are silent. Us thus far. Hallelujah. Take your seats in the presence of the Lord. Put your eyes on the screen. Hallelujah.
Great morning here in the sanctuary and online. Welcome to the year of intentionality here at the Bethel Church. Do me a favor, swipe and invite. Get your people to come in the room. Although you may be inside of the sanctuary, this is the perfect opportunity for you to grab your mobile device, text at least 3 people, and tell them that the worship service has begun. All right, let's get into these announcements. We are also celebrating, along with Black History Month, our very own unsung heroes and sheroes who make great impact in our communities. And guess what? They're members of the Bethel Church. Next Sunday, we will be having our Black History production entitled 1838 Project. This is one that you do not want to miss. Now, we do have some details concerning it. It will not be on our live stream, so you want to make sure that you save the date and that you're in the sanctuary so that you can be a part of this moment. This production is titled 1838 Project, and it tells the story and the history of the Bethel Church from the very beginning. So make sure that you're in the sanctuary. You do not want to miss it. Again, we will not be streaming. Again, guys, we will not be streaming. So on February the 25th at 5 p.m., you want to make sure that you're in the sanctuary. That is a Sunday afternoon. So after you've had a great worship, come join us at 5 o'clock for the 1838 Project. Don't forget Temple Cleanup. Temple Cleanup is going to be on February 24th. We're going to start at 8:30 until 11:30 a.m. Listen, you do not want to miss it. We want you to come out and help us spruce up our sanctuary. We begin in the Jones Scott Fellowship Hall, where you will be assigned your areas and also given some supplies. Join SOS Grief Ministry for the Healing Waters Prayer Call. It's going to be on Monday, February the 26th at 6:30 p.m. Check the number on the screen. Save it to your phone or even write it down. whatever you have to do to make sure that you're on that call. All of these announcements that have been announced today can be found on our website at www.thebethelexperience.com. And to receive our e-newsletter, you can simply text BBICJAX to 54244. You can subscribe, get our newsletter, get e-alerts on all the updates from the church. Our office hours are Monday through Thursday from 10 to 4 p.m. If you need help giving your giving statements, you can call the church during that time and there will be somebody here to assist you. Now, if you give on any of our platforms, you would simply have to go to that app, get your giving statements from there. But if you give through envelopes, you can call the church or send us an email and we'll make sure that we do our best to get you your giving statements. Let us not forget our core values that we love deeply, we worship passionately, we give biblically, we grow intentionally, and we serve willingly. Now let's get back into service.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Thank you, Jeremy. God bless you. Y'all look so good in your African this morning. I bless God for some of y'all got on orange and green. I don't know what that's about, but we'll get to that. We'll get to that a little later. Listen, just a couple of quick things, and then we're going to get ready to move on, introduce our special guest and give and everything. Did I tell y'all Bishop was in church this morning? I just felt like we should have shouted again on that. Praise God. Praise God for that. Listen, if you are a young adult, VIP, Vision Inspiring Purpose, kicked off last month with the wonderful Taco Tuesday. But this coming Friday night, they got something hot and heavy going. They are doing something called bed sheets. Uh-huh. It's going to be a candid conversation about sex. Y'all got real quiet. Love, like, or lust? How do you manage them? The chill is in the room. It always trips me out how some subjects church folk think you ought not deal with. You ought not deal. And it's some stuff Jesus taught on. We don't like the church to talk about money. Jesus taught about it. We don't like the church to talk about sex. Jesus talked about it. You need to talk about these things. It ain't just handing out condoms. No, no. It's handing out the word to teach. Yeah, y'all talk to me for a few minutes. It's not just young people. Our teenagers did a series recently, but young adults have some problems too. In Jesus' name, stay out of Gold Club and Magic City and the Rolex Club. Y'all stay out of them places. Everybody that laughed, you just told on yourself because you have no business even knowing what that is. So join Pastor Dez this coming Tuesday, Friday night at 7 p.m. on the third floor. It's going to be an absolutely amazing conversation that I know is going to be powerful and impactful. Jeremy mentioned it, but I just want to lean in on it a little bit. Next Sunday is going to be an amazing Sunday. It's our old school Sunday. You need to be here on time for devotion. Y'all, see, if you went to Bethel, we did preludes, but we're going back to devotion. So be here on time. Wear your Sunday's best next week. It's going to be a good time. And at 5 p.m., as Jeremy mentioned, I want to encourage you to invite family and friends to be here with us at 5 p.m. as we will tell the history of our life, our journey, our church through drama. One of our wonderful young men who leads our dance, just had a birthday this week. Where's Victor? Is Victor here? Victor Crispin. Victor just had a birthday this week too. Victor has written this production, and he and Pastor Cedric have gotten together and with our entire creative arts ministry at 5 p.m. You ought to be here because there are a lot of people who don't know the real history of this church. We are the mother church.
We are not a twin to any other church, no matter what the media tries to say. Every time they call the name of another church, they put comma the oldest Baptist church. That's a lie. We are the oldest Baptist church. Every church, including First Baptist, that's not a knock, it's an amazing church, has done great things in this city, incredible things. But facts are facts. Ron DeSantis can't watch this fact. We are the oldest Baptist church. And you might not know some of the very special facts of this church, some of the very special people who've been a part of this history. And so next Sunday night, I'm urging you to be here at 5 p.m. because it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful production. Listen, don't forget, more and more we're going to be talking about our core values. Just say with me, we are Bethel. We love deeply. We worship passionately. We give biblically. We grow intentionally. And we serve willingly. Those are our core values. More and more, I'm going to be talking about how I want ministry leaders to be imparting that into all of our ministries. Those are the values that we stand on. Say them one more time with me. Let's say them together. Love deeply. Worship passionately. That's who we are. Those are the values that are at the core of how we operate as a kingdom organization. One of those says we give biblically. We are a biblically based church when it comes to giving. We believe in tithes, but we believe tithe, listen, but we believe tithe is not what you aim for. Tithe is where you start. I got 1, 2, 3, 4. I got 4 claps. We aim to be New Testament givers, which means we give not begrudgingly, because God loves a cheerful giver, but we give, watch this, because we want to be obedient, and we give to the degree that we want it reciprocated. Because the Bible says you reap, y'all help me teach, what you sow. You know, we always use that talking about people. They better leave me alone because you know you reap what you sow. That verse isn't even about that. That verse was within the agricultural symbolism of Paul talking about giving. You reap what you sow. And that's not money. That's not, I have nothing against money. I believe in money. It takes money to live. But contrary to misinterpretation of that verse by many preachers, God does not promise to make you rich just because you give. God does promise to bless you. And how many of y'all know I got blessings money came by? I need blessings money came by. Do I have a witness? So man, we ought to be biblical in our giving this morning. If you are an e-giver as a result of the pandemic now, you play in heaven. I hear that over there. Yeah. If you are an e-giver, our platforms will be on the screen. If you are an old-fashioned giver, envelopes are in the pew. And I need you, listen, to fill out the envelope fully. There are some other things we have going on. Put my bricks up. Why y'all laughing? Put my bricks up. Just give them a minute. They're going to put it up in Jesus' name. They're going to put all my bricks. There we go. Hold on. Let me look at the other barometer. Now, y'all, that ain't moving like I need it to. It's moved a little bit. This is, everybody repeat after me. This is the last week to get my bricks. Y'all got softer with every phrase. Phase one is ending. This is the last week. Don't walk up here after the bricks are in, but I should have gotten my brick. That's what we do. We want to set something in stone to remember and commemorate the 185th anniversary of this church. And this is not, these are not, I should say, memorial bricks. They can be, but they are not simply memorial bricks. It can be in memorial to someone, but it can also be for the living, for you, for your family, for your children, for your business, for your organization. To have an opportunity to etch your name, your family's name, in the pavement of time is a wonderful thing. That in generations to come, when people walk this way to come in this sanctuary, they'll be able to look down and see names of persons, organizations of persons, businesses of persons who have contributed to the ministry of this historical church. We are not a monument, we are a movement. Did you hear what I said? We are historical, but we're not a monument, we're a movement. And I want you to be a part of the movement by putting a brick in the pavement of time. If you have not done that, if you're watching online, there's a way to do that. Jocelyn, if y'all could put, or somebody out here may know, what are they text? I know it's 54244. Thank you. Why y'all laughing? Because I took my glasses off to read it? That's when you know you're getting old. TBC 185 to 54244. Everybody in here could do that right now. If you don't want to stop at the table on the way out, you can do that right. Wait, you can do that after you give your tithe. Then you can text TBC 185 to 54244. You need to be a part of this movement. Come on, ushers. You can be a part of this wonderful movement, because there are many things we have to do, and the proceeds to this can assist us in that. We've got a steeple on the historical building to fix. We've got stained glass windows on the historical to fix. We've got to put, I think, two or three 60-ton HVAC units on this building. We've got much to do, and it's done when we are faithful and liberal in our giving. Y'all give me a good amen. Amen. And so, Father, bless us in our giving commitment this morning, that we can be committed to the cause of the kingdom and how you use this church. Bless us and receive our gifts now. We know that a harvest belongs to us, because your word is true. You reap what you sow, but you also reap where you sow. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give.
Blessed by the Father, I'm anointed to prosper.
Get the key.
He's in the kingdom I have.
Yeah.
He's in the kingdom.
And I have the authority.
I have the authority.
Just to see whatever I see.
See whatever I see.
Cause the favor of God is.
Favor of God is on me.
Yeah.
Favor of God is. Yeah.
I was born to rule.
I was born to rule.
He gave.
He gave me dominion.
Greater works.
Greater works I shall do.
See everything. Said I'm blessed by the Father,
blessed by the Father,
and I'm anointed to prosper.
I'm anointed to prosper.
He gave me keys
to the kingdom I have.
Yeah.
Keys to the kingdom.
And I have the authority.
I have the authority.
Just to see whatever I see.
See whatever I see.
And the favor of God is.
The favor of God is on me.
Yeah.
Favor of God is. Yeah.
I was born to
rule.
See ya.
refreshing time.
Running over.
I'm living in the overflow.
I'm living in the overflow.
You gave to me.
Good man.
Pressed down.
Taking together.
My blessings are.
Running over.
I'm living in the overflow.
Sunday this month, before I introduce our very special guest, we want to do this. Every Sunday this month, the team decided that we wanted to celebrate unsung heroes and sheroes in a variety of categories. We've done community and business. Community and business. And this morning, we're going to do education. Pastor, come on and join me up here. She fly, ain't she? Praise the Lord. All right. Pastor's going to introduce our shero, our unsung education shero this morning.
Great morning, Bethel. We're so delighted that we're able to give people their flowers, amen, while they can smell them. We want to celebrate our Bethelites and the things that they're doing in the community and in the world. And so this week for our Educators Award, our unsung shero is Melody Davis. Yeah, the looks on people's faces, because nobody knows they're getting awarded
right,
this.
Right, right.
And so she hails from Redick, Florida. She's been retired from Duval County after serving for 35 years. She co-leads our Best Academy Saturday School, where our students are tutored and they receive help for 10 weeks out of the year, well, 20 weeks actually every year. And so she started as an assistant director under the directorship of Lady Estelle McKissick, and she kept it going when Lady Estelle retired. We're so thankful for you. We're so honored. She also is a mentor with Achievers for Life with United Way. She does so much in the community for our young people. We're so delighted and blessed that we could celebrate you, Ms. Melanie Davis, for your unwavering service and dedicated efforts to uplifting the standards of education within Duval County and the greater Jacksonville community. Ms. Melanie Davis, an unsung hero, we salute you.
Come on, let's celebrate her again. Thank God for Sister Melody this morning. She's our unsung hero, our unsung hero. He and I grew up together in this church. We were boys since we were boys, grew up as teenagers in this church. You might think it's one person because he has the name of somebody else that's prominent in this church as well. But our educational hero is Kenneth Reddick this morning. Where's Kenneth? I know you didn't know. Come on up here. Kenneth is an executive director, Duval County. He was principal at Maddie V. Rutherford and A. Philip Randolph. He's got over 30 years in the school system, born and raised in this church. I may get a call later on with some words that ain't Christian. He said, you got me on this. He's probably said a few other words y'all can't hear, but Kenneth has been such an amazing force for so many young people in this city, in this state. And we were committed to shining the light on people who do the work, but they're not always on the stage. And my brother is one of those. Can we salute him this morning? Don't call me later. We grew up together in this church, and I thank God for him. I am so excited. What is going on the piano over there? What are you playing? What just happened? Like, it just shifted all of a sudden. Every Sunday, Jesus, we have been committed to our history, and last Sunday and this Sunday, we have been committed to shining the light on two HBCUs. Last week, we had with us Benedict College from Columbia, South Carolina, who did such an amazing job. And this morning, we have from the highest of seven hills in Tallahassee, Florida, the concert choir of the Florida Agricultural and Mechanical University, better known as the FAMU Rattlers. Their wonderful director, Dr. Mark Butler, used to be on staff here at this church. And we salute him, but also to the folk that are hear me, he is a member of the greatest fraternity on planet Earth, Omega Psi Phi Fraternity. Listen, can we give a Bethel welcome again? They bless us every year. Can we give a wonderful welcome this morning to the concert choir of Florida A&M University? Listen to this. Just on the heels of yesterday winning in the National Association of Music Merchants first place. Is that right? They won first place. Now, there was a little petty in the text I got, because the text I got had to tell me that FSU got second place. I don't really know why that was necessary to tell me that FSU got second place. But y'all got first place. I'm going to tell Dr. Thomas. I don't know if Dr. Thomas is here this morning. I don't know if he's here this morning. Hey, everybody stand on your feet. He's a part of Bethel. He was a part of our staff. He is the wonderful director of this concert choir, Dr. Mark Butler.
Troubles of the swell, oh, soon now will be gone. To the one
Come on, stand to your feet and let's celebrate this wonderful choir from Florida A&M University under the wonderful and capable musicianship, Dr. Mark Butler. Come on, let's celebrate these young people today. We thank God for each and every one of them. Hallelujah. Remain on your feet. How many of you believe it's going to work out for the good? Hallelujah. God, we make that bold declaration today. It will work out for the good of them who love the Lord. Thank you for these young people. We speak blessings over their life. We call every bill, every tuition fee, we call every loan met in advance. We call every class passed, every major executed to the glory and honor of your name. Now bless this, your humble servant. Grant unto me preaching power to the end that souls will be saved. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to say, remain on your feet. Go to Habakkuk chapter 3. While you're going to Habakkuk chapter 3, these young people will be dining with us. I want to thank Sister Annette Hughes and her culinary ministry, and of course Pastor Cedric and our worship and arts team for all the work that they've done these last 2 weeks. We are inviting the J.R.E. Lee alumni chapter only to come eat with them. Did y'all hear what I said? Now, if you are a graduate of FAM and you're not in the chapter, maybe they'll have somebody there today that can sign you up for the chapter, and then you can come eat. But we are inviting that chapter to come and eat with them. Mark, Dr. Thomas is watching. He texted me and told me to tell you he's so proud of you and these young people. Both of us studied under Dr. Thomas at Florida State. He told me to tell you he's so proud of you, so proud of this choir today. Habakkuk chapter 3. We are still in our series, Don't Quit in the Pit. This morning we are looking at the pit of despair. What happens when you fall in the pit of despair? Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 16. When I heard, my belly trembled, my lips quivered at the voice. Rottenness entered into my bones, and I trembled in myself that I might rest in the day of trouble. When he comes up unto the people, he will invade them with his troops. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, yes, sir, neither shall fruit be in the vine, the labor of the olive shall fail, the field shall yield no meat, the flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stall. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like deer's feet. And he will make me walk on the high hills. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of our God. Thank you, band, for assisting them this morning as well. I want to talk this morning. I want to preach and teach with this thought in our minds: when God makes no sense. I'm gonna do the best I can. When God makes no sense. I start this sermon off by asking you to be honest about something, even if your honesty is silent. Has God ever ticked you off? What a way to start a sermon. I ask for your honesty. James Baldwin said you can't fix what you won't face. Have you ever found yourself upset with God? Have you ever gone to God secretly, privately, and just said, God, what in the world are you doing? Have you ever just said to yourself, God isn't making any sense with what's going on in my life? Now, I know some of you are going to simply refuse to acknowledge it because you think it makes you less holy and unfaithful. But may I remind you that even Jesus had questions for God. On the cross, he said, God, why have you forsaken me? So I will ask you again and loosen up. Loosen up. Just loosen, roll your neck a little bit. I know you're not an Omega, but roll your neck a little bit and loosen up. And let me ask you again. Have you ever just thought God was tripping when it came to how life was lifing in your life? And I know what Isaiah said. I know what he said in chapter 55, around verse 9, that God's ways are not my ways. I know that. God's thoughts are not my thoughts. I know it. I get it. I recite it. But right now, when I'm in the midst of a perplexing predicament, I have to acknowledge that God and I are having some problems with each other. Ooh, this quiet. Life isn't going according to plan. Who am I talking to? Your story has gone off script. A stack of unexpected bills, troubling marital tension, child going through an unexpected tumor. Then you pray and nothing happens. Nothing changes. You hear no clear word from God. You see no evidence of God's intervention on your behalf. Then your mind gets to racing. Have I offended God? Do I have to clean up my life before God will answer me? Isn't God supposed to do something? Isn't that what God is supposed to do if God loves me? Because isn't that what love does? Doesn't God love me? We ask that question because we haven't yet figured out that you cannot equate God loving you with God catering to you. Preach Rudolph McKissick. And in today's twisted version of theology, it perverts the truth that God is love into the lie that God is cooperative. Did you get that? Just because God is love doesn't mean God's got to cooperate with you. Let's just be honest. And I knew when the Lord spoke this word to me, I knew it was going to be silence of the lambs. I knew, because this hits us in a deep place, because we all have come up with an understanding of how we think God should think and act that fits comfortably into our understanding of how a loving God should think and act. And I want you to know today, you in here on the right Sunday, in the right place, at the right time, to hear about somebody else who had the same wrestle some of y'all are having right now. His name is Habakkuk. He served as a prophet in the latter days of King Jehoiakim's reign over Judah. No king of God's people had ever been as evil as Jehoiakim. He had cut up the scroll of Jeremiah, threw it into the fire. He had no interest in hearing any bad news from God about repercussions for his evil or consequences for the evil of Israel and Judah. Under his leadership, Judah had declined into the most offensive forms of immorality and injustice and violence. And Habakkuk saw it all. And it grieved him. And time passed, and God did nothing about it. Violence grew. Immorality grew. Injustice grew. Habakkuk prayed about it. Got no response. And God's inaction in the face of sin that should offend God made no sense to the prophet. Like, God, How can you claim to be who you are and you letting all this happen? And Habakkuk goes to God in chapter 1. He confronts God and he says to God, are you faithful to your holy character or not? Are you who you say you are or not? Shouldn't you be dealing with all the sin that I see among your people? I thought about that thing. Because when I look at our nation, the description sounds all too familiar, doesn't it? Immorality is everywhere. Injustice still seems to be the order of the day, just with more sophisticated measures. They used to wear hoods and burn crosses, but now they wear suits and write policies. The criminal justice system has created an invisible but real schoolyard to prison pipeline. Economic apartheid cripples the development of our communities, mired in poverty. Governors practice their bigotry by sanitizing the original birth stain of this country, slavery, by trying to wipe it out in the history books. But mind you, there isn't just racism, there is blackism. I'm making up a word. Blackism is when we find ourselves with people who look like us, who are placed in power with the responsibility of looking out for us, but are only put there to control us, Tim Scott. Don't y'all get quiet on me. Not only is injustice everywhere, violence is everywhere. We are killing each other on the streets every night in every neighborhood. The news can't come on without talk of black-on-black crime and gang. Don't get quiet on me in here. Violence is everywhere, and we gather and we pray and we march and we talk, but it seems to go unchecked. They talk about this is one nation under God with liberty and justice for all, but it's more like liberty and justice for y'all, because minorities are still disenfranchised. Women are still treated like second-class citizens. The government still robs the poor to give to the rich. Cancer still has no cure. Crime and murders happen daily. The divorce rate in the church is higher than it is in the world. And God just seems to do nothing about it. And you find yourself, come on, I know I'm rocking your theology, and you find yourself asking like Marvin Gaye, what's going on? If you aren't careful, this world can have you in the pit of despair. And if I'm going to remain faithful, I got to find a way to work through it when God ain't making no sense. Am I talking to anybody in here? Come on. Just be honest. I know you don't want your neighbor to know that you walk on this street, but is there anybody in here right now going through something in your life? And don't give the holy platitudes and all of that, but in honesty this morning, you can just lift your hand and say, preacher, you are messing with me, and I want to get out of here, because right now I don't understand God. And if that's not enough, when God finally replied, it didn't make Habakkuk feel any better. It made it worse. Because God said to Habakkuk, my people are nothing compared to the evil of Babylon. They are way more wicked than y'all. Watch this. Then God said, and I'm going to use them to punish y'all. See, we don't read the Bible. God said, they are more wicked than y'all. But I'm going to use them to punish y'all. Y'all ain't going to like this. Why? Because I don't judge them because they don't belong to me. Y'all don't like this kind of preaching. But I judge you because you belong to me. If they don't belong to me, then I don't hold them. But because you belong to me, I expect you to be different than them. You don't have the right to talk about everybody else is doing it. You don't have the right to talk about it's just the way the culture is. The devil is a lie. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of God stands forever, and his word Everybody else shacking why I can't do it, because you saved. Everybody else screwing why I can't do it, because you saved. Y'all don't want to talk to me this morning. Everybody else getting drunk, why can't, because you're saved. God said, I'm going to use the more wicked nation to punish y'all. And Habakkuk said, you ain't making no sense. God, how is it that my neighbor, who is a drug dealer, living better than me? Y'all don't want this kind of honesty this morning. God, how is it that my coworker, who says the church ain't worth nothing, seems to be happy every day, and I'm struggling? God, how they living together, ain't married, got three kids, and look like they got a better situation than me, and I'm married? It ain't making sense. Then a dramatic shift took place. Touch your name, tell them, thank God. A dramatic. Because if you read chapter 2, Habakkuk stopped talking. Ooh! He stopped uttering challenges to God's sovereignty. He shut his mouth and opened his ears. Y'all don't read the Bible. He said, chapter 2, verse 1, I went from complaining to waiting. Y'all ain't happy. Come here. He said, I went from complaining to waiting. He went from focusing on the condition that confused him to now waiting to hear from God. He went to the watchtower to get high above the noise. I'm talking to somebody today. You might start feeling better if you go from complaining to listening, and from listening to waiting, and from waiting to shouting. Go on and high five your neighbor for the first time and tell him, you got to stop complaining and you got to start listening for what God has to say, and then wait on the Lord to do something about it, because they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Come on, shake your neighbor and tell him, I'm just waiting on him. He ain't fixed it yet, but I'm waiting on him. He hadn't turned it around yet, but I'm waiting on it. I haven't gotten the breakthrough yet, but I'm just. And the verses for our unpacking that I read to you became the summation of Habakkuk's thoughts after he heard what God had to say. Here is how Habakkuk made sense of a nonsensical situation. He went from complaining to praising. I could really end the sermon right there, because what it teaches me is your mouth is your weapon. Y'all don't. No. I know some of y'all are saying, I thought my praise was my weapon. Your praise is only your weapon, because that's what's coming out your mouth. Your mouth is your weapon. Y'all ain't trying to hear me. Whatever you say is what you're going to get. Whatever you say is what's going to happen. So you got to change how you use your mouth and stop complaining and wake up every day saying, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and I will be. Your mouth sets things in motion. Do I have a witness in here? Anybody in here can say, when I wake up every morning, I'm not going to wake up saying, Lord, here I go again. I'm going to wake up saying, Lord, I thank you for another day. I'm not going to wake up saying, I got to go face them demons again. I'm going to wake up saying, God, I thank you for a reasonable portion of health and strength. You got to use your mouth. Let's take a minute and unpack how Habakkuk decided to manage what didn't make sense. Here's the first thing you got to do. You're not going to like it. Y'all been quiet the whole sermon, because I know it's kind of rough. Y'all finna get real quiet. learn how to accept what God allows. Now, this is real teachy right here. There is a difference in accepting what God allows and blaming God for what's happening. Did you hear what I just said? There is a difference in accepting what God allows and blaming God for what's happening. Sometimes what is happening in your life is the result of human choice. I promise you, before it's over, we're going to shout. Are y'all listening? Sometimes you just have to accept what God allows. Watch this. Without claiming that what was allowed was the will of God. Okay, come here. Lean in. How many of you, this is a trick question, have ever been sick? I ain't talking about, hospital sick, but you've just been sick. You have been sick? And it ain't a trick question. How many of y'all been sick? Do you think it was the will of God for you to be sick? How many of you been broke? Do you think it was the will of God for you to be broke? Woo! That contradicts the word of God. It ain't the will of God for you to be sick. Somebody in your family got cancer. You talking about, child, it was just the will of God. No! Woo, y'all are quiet. That young girl caught a straight bullet. You talking about that was just the will of God? Are you crazy? That's not the will of God. Ooh, this is rough this morning. It was the act of violence that God allowed. It's not the will of God that your child act differently than how you raise them in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Your child out there on drugs, you talking about, I guess that's just God's will. That's foolishness. Are y'all going to listen to me this morning? Here's what he said. Although the fig tree shall not blossom. Look at what he said. There shall be no fruit on the vine. The olive shall fail. Here's what Habakkuk was saying. Don't pretend that everything is to your liking when it's not. Come on, I'm doing surgery this morning. He acknowledges bad things are going to happen. He acknowledges Israel is about to catch hell that they won't like and it won't feel good. They're going to lose everything. What they are about to experience was not the will of God. It was the result of their bad choices that now have consequences that God allows to play out. Hey, I told we gonna shout for us over. Don't worry. Stop declaring that everything you go through was the will of God. You flunked that class, that was not the will of God. Child, I guess it was just God's will for me to take it again. No. Sometimes God allows things to play out that are the result of choices. See, I knew. I'm going to do like my dad again. I told y'all Bishop was in church. Right? I'm going to do like my dad again. I got my amen. He stood it over in the old church. I got my amens in my pocket. I put them in there before I left home because I knew what nary person Gonna say amen on this. We don't like to hear this because this means that there are some things I have to own for what's going on. Y'all don't want to talk to me. See, the devil has this is gonna be good. The devil has perfected the gift of deflection in us. We are good at deflecting by blaming other folk so that we don't have to look ourselves in the face and own the part we played for why things are the way they are. We are gifted at deflection. Preach, Rudolph McKissick. Now then, here's the caveat. If God allows it, then there is something that can come out of it that can bless you. It could be a new door of opportunity. It could be a new relationship. It could be a new or deeper level of maturity. But I declare to you today, something good, Jesus, can come out of this. Well, since y'all don't want to shout, let me tell you the first good thing that'll come out of it is that whatever you went through, God kept you through it. That's the first good. I know this ain't for everybody, but this for the 765 of y'all that will shout, God allowed it, I went through it, I didn't like it, it hurt me, I was mad, but God kept me all the way through it, and I got to give him glory, because if it had not been, yes, sir, for the Lord on my side, I would not have made it through it. I dare you to throw your hand up and say, God kept me. Yes, sir. Y'all ain't happy. I said, throw your hand in the air and declare, God kept me. I don't like that my child died, but he's keeping me through it. I don't like that my spouse died, but he's keeping me through it. I don't like that my child is in jail, but he's keeping me through it. I don't like that my child is on drugs, but he's keeping me through it. I don't like that he allowed the divorce, but God is keeping me. All right, let me get a second thing. Let me get a second thing. Number one, accept what God allows. Number two, operate in what I call faith-supported confidence. One word Habakkuk said set him on the track of trust. One word. Read what he said again. He said, although the fig tree shall not blossom. Jesus, I'm about to get happy. There shall be no olive on the vine. He said, and although the fields will yield no meat, the flock going to be cut off. Y'all ready? There going to be no herd in the stall. He got one word. Yet. I did all that and y'all didn't shout. I knew I'd have some students here this morning, so I did my homework. Yet is a contravening conjunction with a subordinating feeling. In other words, yet has the power to negate everything that came before it because of the power of what's coming after it. Y'all ain't happy in here. He said, yet. I dare you just to yell, yet. Yeah, y'all ain't got yet. He said, all of this bad stuff is going to happen. Yet. Yell, yet. Yes. All of this rough stuff is going to happen. Yet. Y'all ain't said it yet. Yeah. Here's what yet means. This suffering will not have the last word. Somebody should have shouted right there. Look at your neighbor. You ain't even got to touch him and tell him, I don't know what you're going through, but you need a yet faith in your life, because whatever you're going through will not have the last word. I wish I had some yet praises in here. Who could say I got a yet praise in my mouth? Because I'm going through it, but it will not have the last word. Because weeping may endure for a night, but joy, I feel a yet praise. Somebody ought to just yell, yet, 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 yet. It will not have the... y'all sit down. Habakkuk says, even if every blessing that provides me with legitimately enjoyed comfort and happiness gets removed, the story ain't over. Y'all don't know. Even if they tell me it's stage four. Even if the divorce goes through. Yes, sir. Even if they fire me on the job. The story ain't over. Come on, encourage your neighbor. I ain't gonna tell you to talk to him too much more. But look at him and tell him your story is not over. Yeah, that was the wrong neighbor because they'd have shouted right there. Turn on the other side and tell somebody your story is not over. They didn't shout it. Turn all the way around to somebody been looking at your back of your head and tell them your story is not over. God is still writing the script and the next chapter of your life is called yet. Yet, God, I feel my Holy Ghost coming. Yet, I will rejoice. In the Lord, it's not over yet. I will rejoice. Okay, let me teach it before I preach it. The word rejoice in the Hebrew, in the etymology of the word, it's the same root word of the English word magnify. Magnify. If you take notes, I need you to write this down. You glorify whatever you magnify. You know, I wear glasses, and I can see because this is right up on me, and I got the font on 28, so I can see that. I can't see this. It's blurry. I can't quite make it out. But I have some magnifiers. That if I put them on, not only does it get clearer, but it gets larger. Woo! This boy's preaching today. You glorify whatever you make large. Whoever glorifies their problem or magnifies their problem, they're going to glorify. They talk like a victim. They want attention. When you tell them what's going on with you, they always got to one-up you by telling you what's wrong with them. They glorify their problems because they have magnified their problems. Their problems dictate and determine their attitude. Your attitude is because of what you magnify. Y'all don't like this. They decide they can't make it. They decide they can't take it. They decide everybody's against them. Are y'all listening to me? Habakkuk says, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will acknowledge that hell is coming, but I won't make what is coming bigger than the God who is. Come on, I'm trying to help somebody get delivered today. I will acknowledge that I'm about to go through, but I will not make that bigger than the God that's going to take me through. I will acknowledge that life is about to get rough, but I will not make it bigger than the God who's going to keep me through the rough times. Magnified. No, nothing will take my attention off of who God is because he's bigger than anything I go through. Am I talking to anybody? So I will rejoice. I will magnify. I will make large. I will make big. I will not allow what is affecting my life to infect my life. I'm about done. I'm going to bless God even when life feels like God is working against me. Because you do know, it's not for, it's only for the 67 of y'all who know this to be true. It is possible to praise God even when you're in pain. God said for the 67 of y'all that's in pain that'll praise him right now, he's going to start to make it feel just a little better. I know that ain't for everybody, but he said for the 67 of y'all that'll give him glory in the midst of what you're going through, he said, I'm going to make it feel better if you learn to praise me even in the midst of your pain. Hey, as a matter of fact, I've discovered that sometimes the most authentic and powerful praise comes when I'm in the most pain. Because when everything is good, my praise ain't all that much. But when life is rough and I'm taking medicine every day and I'm dealing with demons on my job and I can't get my family together, I can give God a praise that'll take me through the rough time. Is there anybody in here who can say, I got a praise even in the midst of my pain? I got a shout even in the midst of my suffering.
I gotta go. I'm done. I've tried to say two things to you so far. Accept what God allows. Operate in faith-supported confidence.
Here's the one I told y'all we were gonna shout before it was over. Sometimes you got to use a flashback to make a forecast.
Y'all didn't get as happy as I thought. I can make a forecast about what God is going to do.
Woo!
When I start having a flashback about the things God has already. I wish I had somebody who could just say, when I look back over my life and I start to think things over. See, that's why I don't even care who becomes the president. I wish we had better options. I don't care who becomes the president. I got flashbacks to every time God has kept us and every time God has lifted us. And the same God that did it then is the same God.
Okay, let me show it to you in the text. Let me show it to you in the text. Sit down. Last time I'm going to tell you that. You're on your own after this. He says two things. I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Now let's do a little Old Testament theology. I will rejoice in the Lord. The word, whenever you see the word Lord in the Old Testament, it is the Hebrew name of Jehovah. Whenever you see the word Lord in the Old Testament, it is the reminder of the covenant God who is faithful to the promises of God. Are y'all with me? He says, I'm going to magnify the promises of God. The promises of Jehovah. That's really what it is. Whenever you see the word God, it is the word Elohim. The word Elohim in the Old Testament stands for the character activity of God that is the delivering nature of God. Y'all didn't get it. He said, I'm going to rejoice in the Lord who's faithful to his promise. But then I'm going to have joy in the God who is my deliverer. And I know he's a deliverer because I've heard the stories of what he did for my ancestors. Y'all ain't helping me. Go back to chapter 2 if you get a chance. He starts reciting and rehearsing everything God has already done. He starts talking about the Red Sea and how God parted the Red Sea. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, neighbor, if he parted Red Seas before, he's going to do it again. That was the wrong neighbor. Turn to somebody and tell him, neighbor, if he brought walls down before, he's going to do it again. That was the wrong neighbor. Turn to somebody and tell him, neighbor, if he multiplied food before, he's going to do it again. That was the wrong neighbor. Get out your seat and find somebody and tell him, neighbor,
neighbor, if he healed the sick before, he's going to do it again, because he's my God from ages past and my hope for years to come, my shelter in the stormy blast and my...
I'm going to join, because my God is a deliverer. I don't know who needs this morning. My joy is going to be in the God who is my deliverer. Now, here's what's deep about this, Bishop. They haven't gone through the captivity yet. And Habakkuk is already talking about having joy. Seems to me I would have joy when the trouble is over. But real joy don't have to wait till the trouble's over. Real joy don't have nothing to do with the trouble you're going through. Joy is on the inside because of what you know about your God on the outside. That's why our ancestors could be called all kind of names, whipped all night long, raped all night long, but then say, this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't. Is there anybody in here who can say, I ain't got the money, but I got joy? Can't find a job, but I got joy. Don't know what's going on with my child, but I got...
He says, the Lord God is my strength.
I like it. He didn't say the Lord gives me strength. The Lord is my strength. That means I don't have to try other options and resources to get through the tough seasons. Woo! I don't need to get my strength from anything, because the Lord is my strength. I don't need what you want to offer me to get through, because the Lord is my strength. I'm trying to hold my hope. He said, and when the Lord is my strength, he makes my feet like hinds feet. A hind are the back feet of a deer that make them swift and sure-footed, that allows them to scamper on hills and mountains and rocky back. Y'all don't even know the shout in that, because I did some study, and there are two types of animals that are not created to climb or walk in high altitudes: rams and deer. Y'all missed your shout. A deer ain't got no business in high places. But when the Lord is your strength, he'll have you walking in areas where you should not be able to survive. I'm done. You ought to get your own shout. But is there anybody in here who can say, I know the Lord is my strength, because I'm surviving where I should have died. I'm surviving where I should have lost it. I'm surviving when I should have quit. Go and high five your neighbor real quick and tell your neighbor, I got deer's feet, because I'm walking in places I should not be able to. I'm doing things I should not be able to do. Don't it shake somebody else's hand. I said I wasn't going to go here, but my soul done got happy, because I know what it's like to do stuff you got no business doing. Because not too long ago, I had a doctor tell me, you'll never preach again. But here I am.
walking on high places. And I might have somebody else who's not ashamed today to stand on your feet and testify right now. The Lord has me walking in places I should not be able to walk, because I gave the Lord permission to be my strength. I got to get out of here. High five your neighbor and tell your neighbor, neighbor, the Lord is your strength. He'll help you climb to the high places. He'll help you walk in the high places. Come on, Quinn, let's ride. Take your neighbor. Take your neighbor by the hand. Rock them and shake them. Shake them and rock them. Rock them and shake them. And tell them, neighbor. Neighbor. Let the Lord give you strength. That was the wrong neighbor. Turn on the other side. Look your neighbor in the face. Put your arms around him. Shake him and rock him. Grab your neighbor. Grab your neighbor. Grab your neighbor and say, neighbor, the Lord is your strength. The Lord is your joy. He'll give you what you need to make it through. Do I have any witnesses? Won't the Lord give you strength? Won't the Lord give you power? Won't the Lord give you anointing? Won't the Lord give you courage? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he fight your battles? Won't he make your enemies your footstool? Won't he give you joy in sorrow? Won't he give you hope for tomorrow? Won't he dry your tears? Won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he? And because I know the Lord is my strength. Because I know the Lord is my joy. I'm climbing to higher places. So this is the last time. High five your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, the Lord is ready to take you to higher ground. That was the wrong neighbor. Turn around, take a neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, the Lord is ready to take you to higher ground. Pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bow. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand. By faith on heaven, tableland, a higher plane than I have. Strength. God is the
rejoice in the Lord. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like hinds' feet. Help me to climb places I don't belong. Stand if you're able. God, you're not making sense yet. I will rejoice. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Here's what's deep. A joy greater than Habakkuk, because the salvation Habakkuk talked about was deliverance from Babylon, but the salvation God gives you is deliverance from sin, the presence or the power rather of sin, the penalty of sin. Doesn't mean you're gonna be sinless, you're gonna sin less, But the penalty of sin has been satisfied by Jesus Christ. Did you hear what I just said? He is the God of your salvation because he sent his son to be the propitiation, the penalty, the sacrificial lamb, so that I don't have to remain captive to my flesh. I can start over. If you're in here this morning, Bishop, I've never accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. I've come to church, but I've never opened up my mouth and said, Jesus, I believe you died for my sins. I believe God raised you from the dead. I confess that I am a sinner and I receive the gift of salvation. Not, maybe not those particular words, but if you've never made a confession similar to that, I'm talking to you this morning. Don't walk out of here this morning without allowing Jesus to be your salvation. Don't walk out of here this morning talking about, I got a good word going to help me get through. Not if you don't belong to him. And you can only belong to him when you come through Jesus. There's no other way. It's Jesus only. That's it. If you don't know Jesus this morning, you've never confessed Jesus. Or second category, Bishop, I am saved, but I don't have a church. I'm not growing. I just kind of go from church to church. I showed up this morning just because fam was going to be here, but I recognize after hearing that word, I need a church where the word of God is taught, where I can get understanding of the word of God, where I can grow, where my family can grow. Third category, Bishop, the only thing I understand is that my life is lifing and I need to get back right with God. We used to sing this song in the old church, get right with God and do it now. Right down at the cross where Jesus shed his blood. Today is the only day you have. You don't have tomorrow. If you're in here, I'm going to ask you to do something, not to embarrass you. I'm not going to put a mic in your hand. I'm not going to ask you your name. This is our way of celebrating you and having an organized way of getting what we need from you informationally. Bishop, I don't know Jesus Christ. I've been coming to church. I thought because I came to church, I was going to heaven. That's not in the Bible. Bishop, I want to be sure that heaven is my destination. If I die today, I want to know heaven is my destination. Bishop, I think I'm saved, but I'm not really sure. But I want to be sure. You're in any of those categories, grab your personal belongings right now and meet me at this altar. You're in the balcony, come to those stairs right now. And don't wait to see who's going to be first. You be first. And watch how God will use you to free up somebody else from fear. You know if it's you, you ought to just grab your stuff right now and begin walking down this aisle right now. Hey, it make no sense to come in the rain knowing you need Jesus and you gonna walk out of here and not make a decision. The devil is a liar. Come on this morning. Come on this morning. I see you coming over here, baby. I see you coming. Come on, come on. All right, somebody broke it. Now you can make your way. Come on, come on. Wherever you are, bless you. Bless your family. Bless your family. Come on, somebody else this morning. Make your way right now. The Lord is waiting on you. The Lord has prepared the way for you. Hey, if you got fear right now, that's a sign that the devil is trying to block your blessing, because God doesn't give you the spirit of fear. So if you're in fear, you ought to break that fear and just start walking right now. Even if you got to walk saying, Lord, I can't believe I'm doing this, just start walking right now from wherever you are and watch how the Lord is going to surround you. My brother running, they running. I'm talking about they running in the balcony. No, no, man, don't hurt yourself, but do what you got to do. Come on, come on.
baby. Huh? This place, but they're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, come on. The Lord is waiting on you. The Lord is waiting. I see y'all coming. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Where are you this morning? Where are you this morning? Where are you? Yes, yet, yet, yet. Do me a favor. Turn to the person on your right and your left, even if you know them. Ask them, is Jesus Christ your Savior? Come on, ask them. If they say yes, ask them, are you a disciple in a church? If they say, what does that mean? Tell them, let me grab your hand. If they didn't say yes to both questions, tell them, will you let me escort you down? So that you can be sure about the direction of your life, and bring them right now, because I got a funny feeling and a sneaky suspicion that there are a few more young folk in this room that's gonna make your way down. Come on, wherever you are, I'm waiting on you right now. This is the no judgment zone. I don't care what you did. I don't care if you did it this morning. The devil should have stopped you from getting to church, because now you've got the opportunity to get it right. Come on, I'm waiting. I'm waiting on you. There's a praise waiting to break forth. Come on, I see you coming. I see you coming. I see y'all walking. Now, I need y'all to praise better than that. Come on, baby. Yeah. Bless you, baby. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you. I said, I need believers. I need believers. I need believers. Not with no cute praise. I need you to go up with a shout. They're still coming. They're still coming. They're still coming. Still coming, walking in the balcony. Still coming, still coming. Still coming, still coming. Still coming, still coming. Still coming. I keep telling y'all every week that the generations that are coming have been young generations. The rest of us ought to be shouting in here. I see you coming. I'll keep the praise coming. A father, y'all not shouting. Hallelujah. Bless you, man. Bless you. Listen now. Anybody else want to come while I'm talking? You come. Hey, what a great decision you all have made this morning. Amazing. Amazing. I'm so delighted. We are so delighted. Everybody in here is just delighted that you are a part of a wonderful, loving people. So here's the deal. I've got a wonderful team with that AIM sign right there. Got more coming. Come on. Wow. Every one of us that are older,
I don't know what the Lord is doing, but young folk are flocking to this church. They just flock. So they're going to take you all, and they're going to get your information and tell you what your next steps are. We're going to get you involved in ministry. Baby, you had you a good time this morning. I watched you the whole service. You had a good time. I know. They're going to get y'all's information, tell you what your next steps are. So if you all can just follow behind them right now. Can we just shout? Wow. Wow. Keep it going. Keep it going. All right. I'm going to ask the concert choir from Florida A&M. Hold on. Hold on before y'all move. Toby, check my phone. Am I missing something? Wow. Hey, somebody from the AIM team, come back. We got some more coming. What? Oh, Shonda's right here. Come on. Come right on. Wow. Wow. Listen, while they're coming, if you are watching online today, and you say, Bishop, I'm not there. But I want to be a part of the movement. All you got to do is text what you see on the screen. Well, you might be in here. Say, I didn't come. Text TB. Wow. Wow. He said they listen to me in New Jersey all the time. And military just moved them to Jacksonville. Decision. That's what you text as one word to 54244. TBC decision. Wow. To 54244. You'll get a text. Click the link in the text. Fill it out. And after you fill it out, send it. And you'll get a response today from our AIM team. Man, the Lord is doing some stuff in here. I saw the blue in the back, but I want to acknowledge the wonderful women this morning from Zeta Phi Beta. We thank God for y'all this morning. Hey, Raven, I see you. Bless y'all for being here. Thank you so much for worshiping. Is this what, for Founders Day? Or y'all just decided to come? Is Founders Week? Oh, 75 years. We are so glad to have you all worshiping with us today. Those of you who are visiting and aren't a part of our ministry, we thank God for your presence today. And come on, let's celebrate them this morning. Thank God for them. Come on, hey, I need y'all to shout for Bishop. Somebody here, help him up now.
I just wanted to stand, number one, and to say, even to those who are getting accustomed to watching on stream, there's nothing like being together. I've been there, and I put every effort I had within me to worship by stream, 96 years old. And for what I have been through in the last 2 months, and to think that God would enable, empower, enlighten me to have the desire of my heart. You know, he does. Jesus says, if you abide in me, my word abide in you, you can ask whatever you wish. God will grant it. And so I'm standing. That fall didn't come from my feebleness. That fall came from where those pink shoes are. That's where it gone. It was sticking out and I was gripped. But I fell down. But yet, I got up. And as I have said many times before, right now, I may have to get Dr. Willis tomorrow. But right now, I don't have a pain in my body. No, no. Finally, I want to thank all of you, because I know if all of you didn't send a card or flowers, both my wife and myself, you didn't do those things, you didn't visit, you prayed for us. And there's a song, son, you grew up under it. Every prayer will find its answer. Somebody say every. Somebody say my prayer. Every prayer. So your prayers have found an answer. I'm back. And thank God. Come on, shake my hand. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, shake it, shake it, shake it, shake it, shake it. Shake it, shake it. Thank you, Pastor.
Come on, let's celebrate our bishop. Let's celebrate our bishop. So I'm going to ask these young people from Florida A&M, the concert choir, they can be dismissed as they go. Can we just show them some love? Man, they were amazing. I mean, absolutely amazing. Now, I've got to take only visiting members. At J.R.E. Lee chapter is what I've been told. 10 of them, they are on the leadership team. I don't know what that means, but I guess y'all know what that means. Gene, you know what that means? Okay. I know who to put in charge. I know who to put in charge of that. All right. I'll put you in charge, Gene. All right. Everybody else now, you got to have a ticket to eat. So you can go over there if you want to. You know, you won't have a ticket. Like Willy Wonka, I never saw that. Ain't that the chocolate factory? I never saw Willy Wonka. Yeah, I never saw no Willy Wonka. I didn't watch that. Listen, as we get ready to go, young adults, don't forget Friday night, bed sheets, 7 p.m. Midweek Manor, 7 p.m. on Wednesday. Hold on. Saturday. God, how in the world did I forget that? What time? 9 a.m. We are doing a temple cleanup. If you remember, we changed the date. I want everybody, listen, you only appreciate what you invest in. We're going to clean this entire campus. I want you to be here. If you got cleaning stuff at home, bring it. We're going to clean together, put some music on, and we're going to beautify the temple of the Lord. I want you here 9 a.m. We're going to share together in beautifying and keeping pristine the palace of the Lord. Then don't forget next Sunday, old school Sunday, be here on time for devotion. It's going to be a good time in the name of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and grant unto you peace. The Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you. Grant unto you every spiritual blessing from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen. Grace, grace.